learn about one of the fastest growing colleges in the Carolinas. We'll be visiting with its president coming up next on Carolina People. Good morning. Welcome to Carolina People. This morning we're at the Fox 43 studio. We're focused on Horry Georgetown Technical College, and we're visiting with its president, Neil Wilson. Good morning, Neil.
Good morning, Greg. Good to be here.
Thanks so much for getting in. It's so exciting to think. And, of course, just yesterday with Mickey Spillane and just so many things going on, the excitement of getting you in now, back-to-back days, it's exciting to get big hitters in.
Well, he'll probably be a hard act to follow. I'm sure Spillane can talk all he wants to in a lot.
But, he did yesterday. He really did a great job. But it's so exciting to get you in. I think so many things going on now at Horry Georgetown. It is amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing what's happening at this college. You know, we've talked about this before, but Horry Georgetown is the fastest growing two-year college in the state. In fact, to give yourself an idea of how much growth we've had, our growth in the fall represented 20% of the growth for the entire technical college system, and that system is composed of 16 colleges and an enrollment somewhere in the neighborhood of around 80,000 students. So our growth rate is significant, and we're mirroring what's going on with our community, and I anticipate we will continue to grow.
Now, repeat that, Neil. The growth in Horry Georgetown, it represents 20%.
Our fall semester growth represented 20% of the system growth. This past fall.
Of the in all 16 schools?
All 16 colleges.
You're kidding. That's gigantic.
And we have, when we first started, when this college first began in 1966, they actually had to pick up Marion County in order to have enough population to justify starting a technical, call them technical centers back then.
Right.
So it was Horry Georgetown Marion Technical Center. Mm-hmm. Marion then dropped off. So from that point in which we had to borrow a county to start this college, we are now the fourth largest technical college in the state of South Carolina.
That is amazing.
5,200 students this past fall.
I know I saw you all had an amazing growth spurt, but to think about that kind of a growth spurt is incredible.
Yeah, we've doubled our growth since 1993.
Oh, Lord.
Twice as we were.
Now, of course, y'all have picked up some extra spaces, some incredible opportunity to grow the college itself.
Yes, we have. Our original campus was Conway, and that campus has been expanded from 15 acres now to 55 acres. Then we bought 20 acres and put a campus on our Georgetown site, which is on Highway 17 on the way to Charleston.
Oh, yeah.
And then we picked up the Grand Strand campus on the old Air Force Base, which is 72 acres. And incidentally, that's a story I need to tell you about, because I think it's a story that will let the taxpayers know just what a great job we did on trying to look after their money. When that base was closing, we recognized that we needed a more presence on the Grand Strand area. Mm-hmm. And we were in on 65th Avenue now, what is old YMCA, and now the Methodist Church owns that. Mm-hmm. We were there, but that was only 10 acres, so we were limited. So we went after these acres through the Department of Education, and they gave Horry Georgetown Technical College 72 acres, six buildings, one being the old middle school, officers club, NCO club, a youth center, and a couple of other buildings. We have put $4.8 million in that campus, and it now has an appraised value of well over $46 million.
You are kidding.
It's one heck of an investment.
Absolutely.
So that's our third campus. And then this fall, the Horry County Public Schools allowed us to use a wing that they had built on the North Myrtle Beach, mm-hmm. eight classrooms that we now have access to after 3 o'clock. For four of them, and the other four we have all day long that we are offering classes. So we now have three campuses and an off-campus site in North Myrtle Beach.
That is incredible. Of course, on the former Air Force Base, you've also recently picked up or gotten some, through the Myrtle Beach Air Base Redevelopment Authority, been able to purchase, I believe, the old base hospital?
Yes, they through the Myrtle Beach Air Force Redevelopment Authority, we were able to pick up that hospital for $150,000.
Mm.
It has been completely gutted. And so exactly what we'd have to do with it, along with 6 acres of land, and that's about 20% of the appraised value of the building and the land. So the authority has been real good to us. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, they gave us $750,000 to renovate the last part of the old existing campus, which was a gymnasium at the middle school, and that will become science labs and classrooms. And mm-hmm. that's going to be there to support when we move all of our allied health to the old hospital building that we hope to have renovated maybe within the next 3 to 5 years.
Dan, you've got a lot. Neil, I was just thinking of Dan Gray, thinking of one of the amazing cheerleaders in the area. There are a ton of cheerleaders in the area. Last Friday, Dan was with us, who's on the state board for comprehensive and technical education. It was so exciting hearing him talk about the thrill of recognizing what Ori Georgetown has done in this community and what it continues to do as a beacon for the entire community technical college system statewide.
Yeah, Dan is the first person that on the state board to represent our area, and Dan has done a great job. He's been a tremendous cheerleader for us. He comes to all of our local college, technical college board meetings, and he goes to all the state board meetings, so he stays in touch. And he has done a great job for us. We're real pleased that Dan got reappointed this year.
You've got a lot of cheerleaders, Neil. You've got a lot of cheerleaders. It's so exciting. Real quick about yourself. Are you originally from the area?
Well, I am from the area in that I was born and raised in Sumter, South Carolina. Mm-hmm. Went to Clemson. Graduated in 1970. We were on the verge of sliding into that recession of 72, 73, back when gas was going to 67 cents. And
right.
Everybody thought that was the end of the world. So there wasn't a lot of opportunities for me. So what I did was I called back to Clemson. They said, well, there's a teaching job at a technical college in Conway, South Carolina. That means close to the beach. I said, well, I never thought about teaching, but why not? Came here thinking I would be here maybe 2 or 3 years and then move on. Fell in love with the process. And then over time, fell in love with a local girl.
Oh, yeah.
Married. She has a great family, and so I've enjoyed every minute. I've been here 33 years. It'll be 34 years this July.
34 years at Ori Georgetown.
Right, Ori Georgetown.
And I think I saw when you arrived in July of 1970 that there were just the three buildings on that campus there on 501.
It was actually only one building on that campus. And there were I think, around 200 students and about 20 employees.
Wow.
And today we're at 260 employees and 5,200 students. So amazing growth.
That's amazing.
Nobody could ever. When they first bought the 15 acres, they really thought that would be all the acres they'd ever need.
Right.
Then they bought a second parcel of 15 acres to make the total 30 and said, surely that's all we'll ever need.
Mm-hmm.
And now we bought an additional, that's 30, 25 acres, and we are already running out of room. And so the Conway campus will soon be maxed out in terms of its capacity.
Mm.
We're basically landlocked, so we can't grow anymore on Conway campus, mm-hmm. which makes the Grand Strand campus that much more important to us.
Mm-hmm. And I think I saw last week you all had a partnership kickoff last Friday with, what was that about, Neil?
Well, the Ori County Public Schools were looking to build a new technology center that will serve 6 high schools.
Mm-hmm.
And this technology center, we used to call those things vocational centers.
Mm-hmm.
But that sort of has a connotation of dumbing down. So we're looking to something that will be high-tech. And they asked us to come in as a partner. And so we're going to break the ground on that partnership. We broke the ground on that partnership
right.
last Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be about a $14, $15 million project, serve 6 high schools. And not only will it have technical programs there, but it'll also have some of your higher-level academic programs with some of the highest-level achievers in the county. So we think it's a wonderful opportunity for us.
Golly, Neil. I go back to thinking about you arriving in Conway in 1970 and, of course, then meeting Ann and y'all getting together and the excitement there and something keeping you here. What was it over those first few years that were so exciting about? Was it just being in the classroom? Was it communicating with students? Was it seeing them grow in the classroom?
Well, I love the outdoors, so this was a natural area for me in terms of all of the outdoor activities that you can do. My old college roommate was born and raised and had moved back to Merle's Inlet, so there was a connection there.
Yeah.
And I did fall in love with the teaching process.
Mm-hmm.
The first class that I taught, I probably was the youngest person in that class. There were 14 students, most of them rural Ori and Georgetown County students. It was a second, it would have been the first graduating class, and when we graduated that class, I think about 11 or 12, they all got jobs, good paying jobs for that time, and I just fell in love and recognized what we were doing for people who would otherwise probably not have opportunity to go on for education.
And I think I saw even more recently in a press release that came out or otherwise that there's a 94% on the graduation rate of folks that get into jobs or...
That was last year in
right.
a very, very slow time in terms of our economy. In fact, the worst downturn I've ever seen. But,
mm-hmm.
yes, we placed 94% of our graduates last year. In addition to that, equally as important, 94% of all of our graduates who have to take a licensure, such as our nurses, our radiologic technology students, and others who have to take a license in order to practice, passed the first time they took that licensure. And that's really good if you look at statistics across the state. A lot of people don't recognize that two-year nurses, in order to be registered, take the exact same examination as baccalaureate degree nurses. So if you're a registered nurse, you are a registered nurse. And so the fact that we are able to have that kind of pass rate in 2 years as opposed to 4 years of education, I think is phenomenal.
Are you still able to get in the classroom, Neil?
Yes, what we have some classes where we have some students who are taking something called a freshman experience.
Right.
And I try to get through three or four of those classes a semester and talk to those young people about how good, what the opportunities are in higher education today, why it's so important that they continue their education. And then if you look statistically, what they're telling us now that in this state, and let's take a minute, ratchet back when I was in high school, 1965, so I was telling you my age. if I was sitting there, here's what, Greg, you'd say to me. You'd say, Neil, let me tell you about this state. 20% of the jobs require a baccalaureate degree, 65% of the jobs you can do with a high school diploma, and 15% of the jobs you need some sort of additional training beyond high school but less than a baccalaureate degree. Ratchet forward to 2004, and I'd say this to you, you'd say this to me. You'd say, it's still 20% of the jobs require a baccalaureate degree. What has changed now? Only 15% of the jobs you can do with a high school diploma, and 65% of the jobs you have to do with some sort of advanced training. So those two figures have reversed. So I tell them, absolutely, you've got to go on to school. You cannot survive in this competitive world from a work environment with just a high school diploma, unless you're going to be satisfied with 15% of the jobs. The problem that we're having is that there's a disconnect between what's the jobs that are available and the training that's needed to meet those jobs. You got far more people chasing the baccalaureate degree and 20% of the jobs, and far less people chasing the associate degree and 65% of the jobs. And that's not downplaying the baccalaureate degree, because I think that's very, very important. But I think it's an area that we've got to work on so that our young people can make some informed decisions, that the bulk of the jobs are out there for two-year degrees, which if you wanted to later on, you typically can transfer and go on and get your baccalaureate degree.
You can take your credits from Horry Georgetown or any of the many technical colleges throughout the state.
You
and apply
can transfer
those.
Our credits to all of the state-supported institutions in the state and almost all of the private institutions in the state.
Last week, we were visiting with Dalton Floyd, the chairman of the Commission on Higher Education. He was talking about a pretty alarming number, Neil, regarding the instance of folks who start ninth grade and do not finish within 5 years, not only 4 years, but 5 years. And I think he said in the state of South Carolina, it was almost half the folks who start ninth grade. That's, it was either 52% or 49%.
Yes, I think it's 49% of ninth graders do not finish high school in 5 years after they get in ninth grade.
Which is, what's going on? I mean, of course, this is before they would even arrive at Horry Georgetown Tech or any of the...
Well, that's a $64,000 question.
Yeah.
What's causing this? I don't think anybody knows, and we're dead last in the country on that figure, incidentally. The average is 65%.
Is that
which
right?
Is a little bit shocking that the average in this country is 65% of the people go ahead and get their high school diploma. I don't know what the problem is. I do know that that makes your local technical college that much more important in terms of accessibility for people who did not finish.
Right.
And it also makes your adult education component, people can go back and get their GED, that much more important for a large segment of our society and for our workforce in South Carolina. And that's critical, because if we're going to be competitive, I'm also happen to be this year, I'm chairman of partners, and we recognize that if we're going to be competitive, we have got to somehow increase the skill sets of the workforce, not only in Horry and Georgetown County, but in this whole state, to get the track the kinds of jobs we want to track that are going to be clean jobs yet pay well.
Yeah, that I'm sure that must be difficult, Neil, at times on the partners trail, getting out there. And I don't know how you find the time to do it. It blows my mind. Folks, somehow I know you make the time, but it's amazing that ability to go out and really recruit heavily when education such a potentially difficult topic for folks coming
well,
in.
Well, I'm fortunate because some partners has a great staff, and Joe Woodle and his staff do a great job in running partners and going out and trying to lure industry here. So I just sort of front for him and back him and run the board meetings for a year. But, yes, they do a great job with a minimal budget when you look at what they have to try to, what they're competing against in this state and other parts of the state. We have a tough time competing with North Carolina and Georgia and Virginia.
What do you? Well, and what is it about those states that make it difficult? Is it not only that education side, but
not so much the education side. To some extent, yes, it could be, but most of it is their wealth and their ability to offer incentives. Mm-hmm. And some cases, it may be road systems. What hurts us in Horry County is the lack of an interstate, which hopefully I-73. I'm going to Washington with a group later on this month, and hopefully we're going to get I-73. Coming into here, that's going to make a difference. That's why we're trying to sell the Cool Springs Industrial Park, because that's the closest industrial park we have to I-95.
Mm-hmm.
I think
mm-hmm.
it's around 35 or 40 miles you can be on I-95. Right. So that's a key component to attract industry.
That is, very definitely. Golly, Neil, to be in this position now. Now, you just celebrated your second anniversary as president of Horry Georgetown.
Yeah, my second anniversary as full-time president. I was interim president for a year prior to that, and then interim president for about 4 months prior to that.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think I saw you'd served as an executive vice president for a good 10 years leading up to that.
Yeah. I've done just about everything out there, which would be natural. 34 years, what else can you do? This is a job that I have thoroughly enjoyed.
Mm-hmm.
It's a job that has a lot of self-satisfaction to it. I am blessed with a wonderful, wonderful staff. Mm-hmm. We've got some tremendous teachers, and the staff that support them and me are just outstanding. And being totally unbiased, I would say that academically we are as strong, if not stronger, than any of the technical colleges in the state.
Mm. Wow, you can sit back and say that. And speaking of that, as I think about it, of course, you pointed out baccalaureate degrees are so important still throughout, even though it's going after a real small segment of the workforce. That aspect of having a son who's a 1L at Emory Law School, another son who's a junior at Wofford, and a daughter who's a junior in high school, when you all would talk about school at home. And, of course, it's just that opportunity to be. I was so excited to see those figures recently in Horry Georgetown Tech at a foundation board meeting of the median student, just to give that opportunity to a child or a young adult, a 26-year-old, a single woman, oftentimes a single parent. And those figures are a pretty big deal to be able to give those people an opportunity to be in their skill at the same time as being in the classroom.
Well, I think many times first of all, we pride ourselves on being a second opportunity institution for people, having nothing to do with their intellect. They just didn't take the first opportunity. And now they find themselves 27 years old as an average, group predominantly female, about 70% female.
Mm-hmm.
Close to 80% of our student body work full or part-time. So they're in a situation where they can't just pack up and go to Clemson or Carolina or even Coastal because of the tuition difference. Mm-hmm. And so if we did not exist, I don't know where these people would go to try to improve their skills and their employability.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a wonderful opportunity. And we see that what you saw at our foundation meeting with that testimony from that young lady we see it every day. And it really just makes you feel well about what you're doing.
It does. You're really able to connect.
Yeah,
you're able to connect. And it's so important, I'm sure, for folks on the side, on a donation side, for instance, to know that they can connect to the students to really touch and feel the folks that are benefiting. Of course, there's amazing groups like the Heart Association, the Cancer Society, and those funds are well raised to fight research or to fight heart disease and stroke, for instance. Good for research. The money goes out. It may come back to the state, but you're not able to really necessarily touch and feel. You know folks who've died from a heart disease or stroke, but you can't touch and feel the scholarship students or the books that you're supplying.
Well, and it not only affects them, it affects their families.
Mm-hmm.
And they're so appreciative of what we do for them and the ability to go to school and the finances it takes to go to school. But when you're trying to go to school and you don't know whether your car can get fixed or you got to decide whether you're going to buy books, get your car fixed, or send your child somewhere or do that and the other, it really puts a lot of burden on these people. And quite honestly, a lot of them are successful in school, when many people, like myself, probably would throw our hands up and say, "It's just too much, I can't do it."
Right, or just drop off the face of the earth, you'd do.
That's it, I can't do it.
Speaking of those kind of burdens, what about the burdens for Horry Georgetown Tech itself? What are some of the challenges facing the college right now?
The biggest challenges we've got, and probably 25 years from now, the next president will be saying the same thing, but is our finances and our ability to do what we need to do, because A, we got things that are causing us problems, like our growth rate, because mm-hmm. our tuition is legislatively mandated to be low,
mm-hmm.
so it doesn't cover the cost. And at the same time, while we have grown some by 1,000 students since 1997, we've grown by 1,050 students, but yet that's the rate at which we're being paid by the state. They're paying us the same amount of money they paid us in 1997 because of what's going on with the economy. So we struggle trying to keep up with technology and keep up with faculty salaries. And we've got a lot of buildings that were built in the early 70s, middle 70s, that got to be renovated, as well as additional space. So those are basically our challenges.
How can the college sustain? You know, you're talking about the state appropriations for fiscal year 2004 would be virtually identical to the state appropriations in
1997-98.
How can it sustain? I mean, and with that kind of growth?
Well, we've had to increase our tuition. That's one way we did it. We've done a lot of things to become more and more efficient, to the point that we've actually had most of our administrators are teaching at least one course now.
Mm-hmm.
And we have allowed our class sizes to get a little bit bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And so we've done those kinds of things, but we are basically to the point now that we may have to say, you can't get into Old Ridge Georgetown Tech this fall. You'll have to wait till next year because we can't take any other students.
Mm-hmm. That would be very tough.
Well, it never has happened in the history of the state, but it may happen.
And I guess that could potentially even happen in some of the other areas around the state, or is Ori Georgetown Tech's growth just too...
No, it can happen. We talk about this on a system level,
mm-hmm.
and it's already happening in your allied health programs. For example, I told you at the foundation, our Red Tech program is already accepting people in 2007.
Mm.
Our nursing program's 2005, 2006, so mm-hmm. we're already having to tell people, you've got 2 to 3 to 4 years before you can get in school with us.
Neil, we got about 5 minutes. How has technical education changed, and what changes do you foresee over, let's say, the next four years?
Well, what's changed in technical education, first of all, the mission of technical education to improve the employment skills of the citizens of South Carolina, that mission has not changed.
Right.
What has changed within that mission is that it's a much more complex role that we must play in terms of the skills that workforce needs.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the basic change that I see. The changes that I see in the future are going to be continue to brand ourselves as a viable higher education entity, that we're worthy, that our programs are academically sound,
mm-hmm.
that young people need to at least consider us as an option.
Mm-hmm.
And to allow people to better understand the role that we play in terms of the economic development of this state. I feel like in the last 3 or 4 years that we've lost a little bit of ground in terms of our the public opinion of our role in economic development, and that the senior institutions, primarily the research institutions, have gained the higher ground on that.
Really, Neil? What makes you think that?
And that's where you begin to see a lot of talk about endowed chairs and research and how research will be the key to the economic engine of the state, and I think it will be. I don't argue that, but you have to have the next component to that research. Somebody's got to be training people to implement that technology that they're creating in research.
Absolutely.
So I feel like we're getting kind of lost in that shuffle a little bit. And it's always difficult when you're caught between senior institutions with a lot of alumni in the General Assembly and K through 12 have a lot of local and personal appeal. Then we sort of sandwich in the middle, and we have to keep waving our hands and say, hey, don't forget about us. So that's always going to be a challenge.
And what are some of the things that are being done to help get the word out, Neil? I mean,
what we're doing today.
Right, sure, absolutely.
We put out quarterly reports, put out an annual report that we mail out. We are constantly bringing in the county delegations and our local delegations and talking to them about our importance. Recently, for example, one of the things a lot of people don't know is that what was then called special schools is now called the Center for Accelerated Technology, which is a part of the technical college system that will come in for new and expanding industry and train specifically to what that industry needs at no cost to that industry is part of our system.
Mm.
And I think now that we say Center for Accelerated Technology, some people are not making that connection yet.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that is a viable part of why this state is being as competitive as being. And in fact, a Kansas study, state of Kansas did a study, said find out which state does the best job of training their workforce. This was last spring. They did a national study, and guess who came back first?
Well, I'm sure.
South Carolina Technical Education System does the best job of training the workforce.
That is fantastic.
In the country. So we have a tremendous national reputation. We just got to build up our local reputation.
And there are a lot of partnerships that are happening. We got a minute, Neil. There are a lot of partnerships that are happening on the local level with local businesses. I think about hospitals. When you talk about the nursing programs being so far, I mean, you know, the enrollment, getting into those programs being so far behind. Are you able to work with the hospitals locally, the four or five?
Hospitals work with us very well.
Right.
In fact, we hope to make a major announcement about a major donation from Georgetown Memorial Hospital in the next couple of weeks. But the hospitals allow us to utilize their facilities. We have to have them to do our training.
Mm-hmm.
We also have a significant partnership with Brook Green Gardens, which is where we offer our horticultural program.
Right.
Fortune School of Real Estate, we're in partnership with them on a lot of their real estate training. So we're in partnerships. We're in partnership with Coastal Carolina and the College of Charleston, where they come in at our two-year criminal justice degree. They can stay on that Grand Strand campus and get the last 2 years of a baccalaureate degree by taking courses from Coastal and from Charleston Southern. Mm-hmm. So we have a number of partnerships.
Right. Neil, lastly, if you weren't currently the president of Horry Georgetown Technical College, what do you think you'd be doing?
I would probably be a forester somewhere in the southeast, but where it would be, I don't know. But I love the outdoors, and even though this job is not totally outdoors, I get to meet a lot of people, and it's been a wonderful ride for me.
He arrived on Horry Georgetown Technical College campus there in Conway, one building in 1970, July of 1970. He'll be celebrating 34 years at the same institution in just a couple of months. Something kept him here. Being in the classroom, being in the outdoors, being with a wonderful woman who's now his bride. We're happy he's here. Neil, thanks so much for being with us this morning.
Appreciate it, Jordan.
Absolutely. Stay tuned to more Carolina People coming up next. We want to thank President Neil Wilson and all the staff, faculty, donors, folks throughout the community, volunteers, everyone who has such an impact on Horry Georgetown Tech for making today's Carolina People so special.